Good morning to everyone. We're having an online worship service today, and that's because of the high level of COVID infection in both congregations at present. We've got multiple families in both congregations isolating, with some family members having more than one affected member. We hope and pray that everyone affected will have a speedy and uneventful recovery. This morning, while Philip's on holiday, we have Mr. Billy Patterson leading our worship. Many of us will remember Billy leading a mission in the congregations some time ago. You're most welcome, Billy, and we look forward to your opening up the scriptures and leading our worship this morning. During the week, we're planning to have a midweek prayer meeting, but because of the COVID, we've already decided that it would be best to be online, and we'll get the details we could get from Mervyn Copes. Next Sunday, we're hoping that Jackie Blue will be able to lead worship in person in both congregations. We'll see later during the week whether that's possible, whether it will be online next Sunday as well. It's with regret that I would like to announce the death of the grandson of Eileen and Ronnie Bickerstaff in a work accident last Monday. Our thoughts and prayers are with Eileen and Ronnie, the grandparents, Paul the father and his family following the death of Matthew. I'll now hand over to Billy to lead our worship today. Thank you, Billy.
Well, thank you, Alistair. And it's good to be with you this morning, and just pray that God's blessing will be upon us. I want to read some verses to you from Psalm 18. This is God's word. He reached down from on high and took hold of me. He drew me out of deep waters. He rescued me from my powerful enemy, from my foes who were too strong for me. They confronted me in the day of my disaster, but the Lord was my support. He brought me up into a spacious place. He rescued me because he delighted in me. Ending there at verse 19. I'm going to pray just for a moment. Let's just bow our heads and we'll pray. Father, we thank you again this morning for the privilege of being able to come into your presence. Thank you again for your great goodness to us throughout the past week and for how you provided for us in so many ways. We thank you for the clothes that we wear and the food that we eat, for friends and for family. And thank you, Lord, loving Father God, for health and strength. Praise you, loving Father God, again too, for the rain that makes things grow. And we see that as we drive through the country, just the beauty of it all and God's great goodness to us. We remember again the turmoil in so many families again this morning. Remember those, loving Father God, who have been bereaved tragically, and we ask your blessing upon them. Pour your love upon them. And Father, we just pray that this service today being streamed will bring glory and honour and praise to your name and exalt you. And Father, we ask all these things, giving you thanks in Jesus' precious name. Amen. And we're going to sing together, Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
going to read God's word to you now. If you have a Bible, I'm handy. The reading is from 2 Samuel and chapter 5. And we'll be reading from verse 3. 2 Samuel and chapter 5 and verse 3. Again, this is God's word. When all the elders of Israel had come to King David at Hebron, the king made a compact with them at Hebron before the Lord, and they anointed David king over Israel. David was 30 years old when he became king, and he reigned for 40 years in Hebron. He reigned over Judah for 7 years and 6 months, and in Jerusalem he reigned over all Israel and Judah for 33 years. The king and his men marched to Jerusalem to attack the Jebusites who lived there. The Jebusites said to David, "You will not get in here. Even the blind and the lame can ward you off." They thought, "David cannot get in here." Nevertheless, David captured the fortress of Zion, the city of David. Ending there at verse 7, and we just pray that God will bless this public reading of his word. And we're going to sing again, "My Jesus, My Savior." Lord, we just thank you again that there aren't any special places where we can meet with God. We thank you again that you're everywhere, and we praise and bless and thank you for that. I want to pray, Lord, again very specially today for those who have been affected by the pandemic, those who have been affected locally here, and those who have been affected worldwide. And Father, we just thank again and pray again for those who have lost loved ones and it all. And we ask your blessing upon them in a very special way. Pray, Lord, very specially today for doctors and for nurses and for all who work in the National Health Service, that you would remember all of them and bless them, and Lord, protect them and pour out your love upon them as well. We commit them to you. And pray, Lord, Father God, again too, at this time of year, for all the work that's involved with children. Pray for CEF and Bible Club movement, for all the 5-day clubs that are taking place around our country at the present time, and even camps that are happening. We give you thanks for those as well. We pray for all the boys and girls who go along to them, and all the leaders, that your blessing will be upon them, that you will protect them, and that you will watch over them and pour out your love upon them. I think very especially this morning of people in Greece, Lord, where this wildfires are burning, and Father, great destruction happening and loss of life. And pray, Lord, very specially, and for all those who are involved in trying to put the fires out, that your blessing will be upon them. We think too, dear Lord, of the war in Afghanistan continuing there, and again, hundreds of people dying unnecessarily. And we pray into that situation that you will step in, and Father, remember all those in Afghanistan today who love you, and Lord, who are worshipping you, and we ask your blessing upon them. And again, Lord, we just think of unrest in so many places around our world. And Lord, we commit all that to you today as well. Commit it to you and ask your blessing upon it. Pray, Lord, again for all those involved in the media of reaching out today. We think of Fever Radio, and we pray for them. God bless them. And Transworld Radio, that you'll remember them as well. And UCB, that your blessing will be upon them as well. Pray for Barnabas Fund today, and for all the great work that they do. For Tear Fund, God bless them. Open Doors, and pray for them and the work that they're involved in. And Father, for Middle East Reform Fellowship, that you would remember them as well. And remember Victor and Lisa Atala and the work that they do. Especially, Lord, we pray for the radio programs that are being made and sent out to many places around the world, that God will bless them and undertake for them. Again, our Father, we pray for the government here in Stormont. Pray for the government in Westminster as well. And it seems that they're always in turmoil. We want to pray for them. We want to pray, Lord, that common sense will prevail in many of these situations, and that God's hand will be upon them all. Lord, we commit it all to you. Pray for our leaders, that God's blessing will be upon them, and undertake for them all. And for your church here in Ireland today, we pray for your church in Ireland. Pray, loving Father God, again for all the congregations that are vacant at this time, that God will raise up godly men for them as well. Father, we commit them all to you. We just pray again for the tremendous need for revival, Lord, in the church. And we ask, loving Father God, that you will move our hearts in a very special way. Lord, just to hold on to you and to pray believing that God is able to do what we see as impossible. God can make it all possible. Lord, we commit all these things to you right now and give you thanks for everything in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Well, it's good to have you along this morning, and I want to thank Oscar for his welcome to me and for the privilege of being able to come here and be able to speak to you this morning. I'll just take a second off for a moment. Those verses that I read to you, you could turn to them just for a moment. In 2 Samuel and chapter 5 and verses 3 to 7. Let me say this to you. If you were to go to Jerusalem today, you would find it very easily accessible. There are dual carriageways into the city from all different directions. Buses coming in and taxis coming in and bringing in tourists from all different parts of the world. There are lorries ferrying goods from all over the country to shops, to restaurants, to hotels, and from all over the country they're coming in. But it wasn't always like that. There was a time when it was a fortress, and we want to look about that this morning here. It was a place where there were high cliffs and wide chasms, and it was closed up. It looked impregnable. And when to the naked eye, it was inaccessible. That's what it looked like. Except we're told for one narrow road that was very easily defended. It had been captured twice by the Israelites in the past, but they were never able to hold on to it. And they always lost it again. It was captured in Judges chapter 1 and verse 8, and again in Joshua chapter 11 verses 1 to 8. But when we come to 2 Samuel in chapter 5, it's about 400 years since the Israelites lost it. And with hindsight, and hindsight is always a wonderful thing, we can always see plenty of stuff by hindsight. And we can see that there's something very important about Jerusalem. Something very important about this city. And it seems that the devil is determined that the Israelites won't be able to have this place. And maybe it's the fact that it's been lost and won back again in the past. that the Jebusites have this tremendous confidence that they can't lose it. And when King David comes with his men and his great army to take the city, in verse 6 there, it says the king and his men marched to Jerusalem to attack the Jebusites who lived there. The Jebusites said to David, "You will not get in here. Even the blind and the lame can ward you off." That was the confidence they had. Even the blind and the lame are able to defeat you. They're saying you can't come in. You can't win in this situation, in it all. Now, here's something to keep in mind. Keep in mind that this is God's anointed king at the gate. And this is something that's tremendously important in it all. And the thing that strikes us, there is no record of any battle. Now, you would imagine that when the king comes to the gate and this great army comes up to the gate and the Jebusites would let them in, you would imagine there would be a tremendous loss of life in it all. That's what you would expect. But it's very clear that that didn't happen. Didn't happen that way. Verse 7 states in a very matter-of-fact way, "Nevertheless, David took the stronghold of Zion." Not just that they took Zion, but that the Holy Spirit emphasizes that it was the stronghold of Zion. The devil has a grip on this place. And God wants us to see that he secures this place in his own indisputable way. That David was outside the gate with his vast army. All his mighty men were there. And it's here that we're reminded of God's word to Zerubbabel in Zechariah and chapter 4 and verse 6. And here's what it says. "And so he said to me, 'This is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord Almighty.'" The devil's been guarding this place since forever. He has convinced the residents that God's anointed king can come in. And again, with hindsight, we can understand why the devil doesn't want to lose Jerusalem. That we know that God presences himself here. God came here to this place. This would be his dwelling place. A great temple would be built here. It would be a place of sacrifice, a place where sins would be forgiven. There would be people drawn to hear from all over the world. The Queen of Sheba would travel to this place hundreds of miles on a camel. Here was a woman with all her wealth and all her power, and yet she had questions that she had no answers to. She were told that she came to test Solomon with hard questions. Questions about, what's life really all about? Why am I here? What will happen to me when I die? And those are the same questions that people have in our world today. They're no different. We're right down to all the ages. There is no difference. And not only did people come here from all over the world, there would be great and mighty revivals here. When whole nations would seek God, and Israel especially would seek God. And then too, there would be great falling away, or turning away from God, forgetting God's goodness in the past, rejecting his guidance in the present, just like us, just the way we behave. And if God were to mark iniquity, none of us would be able to stand. And even though this place would be ransacked, the temple destroyed, and God's people taken into bondage, God would raise up godly men again. And Nehemiah would come back and build the walls. And I hope that this encourages you this morning. Have you ever considered Nehemiah? He had never been to Jerusalem. A man who was born in exile, but was powerfully burdened for Jerusalem. Ezra would return, and the temple would function again. Revival would come, and great joy would fill the hearts of the people there again. And you can imagine the pattern that's happening here, right down to our day. We had revival here in 1859, and again in the 1920s. And look where we are today. Tremendous falling away all around us. But this is all preparing us for God's final anointed King coming, the Lord Jesus Christ. He was coming to Jerusalem as well, but Jerusalem didn't want him either. Jesus tells the parable in Luke chapter 19 and verse 14. He says, the citizens hated him, saying, we will not have this man to rule over us. And that's how people in Jerusalem felt about Jesus. And it's about how people in our world today feel about him as well. But Jesus came to Jerusalem and gave his life on a cross. And what the devil thought was a tremendous victory turned out to be his greatest defeat. That Jesus died and he rose again. He conquered the grave and he lives today in the power of an everlasting life. And we know that today that Jesus doesn't come to Jerusalem anymore, not in the physical sense anyway. Today, God's anointed King comes to individuals like you and me, to our families and to our communities. Maybe you thought others thought too that God can't get in here. You look at somebody's life and you think God can't get in here. They're too hard or too difficult. But nevertheless, grace found a way. Tremendously important to understand that. Maybe your family and to the human eye and from a human point of view, you're closed up to the gospel. And you know you have to believe that nevertheless, love can find a way. Now I do some door-to-door work in Uri and around Banbridge as well. And one day working in Uri, I came across a young woman and she had just become a Christian 2 weeks earlier. And she simply said to me, you know, I've done everything, tried everything, couldn't find any happiness in anything that I do and anything that I did. And I just felt lost and I felt empty inside and thought, this is life, just get on with it. She came from a different tradition than I came from, but someone invited her along to a Christian meeting. And she went along there and she heard the good news about what Jesus can do. And she trusted in him and asked him to be her savior. And what she said was, you know, life has changed completely in 2 weeks. Her life had changed completely. That she trusted Jesus to come into her life and save her. And she, what you see is, nevertheless, grace can make a way. I was preaching in a church one Sunday up the country. And what usually what happens was the minister took me home for lunch, and we were talking, and I asked him about his family, and he told me that he had two daughters and a son, and he said, my son, when he was 16, he just said to me, Dad, I'm not going back to church again. And he said he left school, and he got a job, and every Sunday morning he got up way earlier than we got up, and he went off. He didn't know where he went, and he came back Sunday night and we were in bed, and that went on for a few years. And he said we couldn't talk to him. And he said one Sunday morning I got up in the pulpit, I was preaching, and I got up and I looked down and I saw him there. And he said I couldn't believe that it was him. And he said, as I preached, I just lost a run of myself. I couldn't get my head around, why is he at church? What has happened to him? And at lunchtime, I said to him, it was good to see you at church, and why were you there? And he said, coming home last night in the car, Dad, I just broke down and God spoke into my heart. And he said, I stopped the car and I repented of my sin and asked Jesus to come into my life. Nevertheless, grace finds a way. And you know, that's a most wonderful thing. And his father said to me, you know, he's the greatest asset that we have in the church at the moment, working with our young people. It's a wonderful thing. Another friend of mine who was on the phone to me this week, who lived in Kilkenny and that I'd known for several years, hard man. He had become a millionaire, was telling me that he came to actually see me, wanted to tell me a story, tell me about walking down the red light district in Amsterdam one Saturday night. He was over in Amsterdam with a group of people from Ireland who were interested in vintage cars and motorbikes. And he said that this was a trip they walked down through the red light district. And as he walked along, a man came and walked along beside him and spoke to him in perfect English and said to him, "Do you know something? If you die in this place without Jesus, you'll go to hell." And he said, "If Jesus returns again and finds you here and you haven't got him as a saviour, you'll be lost for all eternity." And this friend of mine said, "You know, I was stuck to the ground. I couldn't move," as he spoke to me. And he said he gave me a Bible in English. "You take a Bible?" And he said, "I had a Bible, but I didn't want to say no, so I took it." And he said, "I came home, and the following Monday I was driving down the Naseby carriageway under this tremendous conviction. And he said, I couldn't believe it. The tears were running out of my eyes. And I said to God, 'God, what's this world really all about?' And it said, he seemed in a moment that everything turned to clay. And God said, 'That's what it's all about. That's how it seemed.' And he said, I put it into the heart shoulder and just wept myself into the kingdom of heaven." You know, nobody could have touched that man. Nevertheless, God made a way. It's the most wonderful thing. And, you know, here we are today. And, you know, we look at people in our families, we look at people that we work with, and we think God can't touch them. Nothing can touch them. But nevertheless, God can make a way. And don't ever buy into the idea that God is not able to save the hardest of people. And this story this morning that we see David marching up to Jerusalem, and where there could have been, and we would have expected to find that it was a bloodbath, there didn't happen, because God stepped in and God made a way. And God does that again and again and again. And we need to keep that in mind and never forget that God is able to do these things. And may you be moved. May you be moved today to believe that God hears and answers prayer. That God can revive us again. That God can revive me again. And God can revive you again. And that things can change in a most wonderful way. And it only happens when God moves. There's no other power on earth can change any of us in the way that God can. So may we be able to trust him and ask him to come into our life and be our saviour and our friend and take us forward. Let me pray with you for a moment. Father, thank you again just for the privilege of being able to look at your word, the Bible. And Lord, thank you again that there isn't anything in all the world that's too hard for you or too difficult for you. That you can do anything but you can't feel. And God bless, Lord, all the people today all over the world who are sitting under your word as your word is being proclaimed. Father, may it go with great power. Father, may hearts be changed and lives be changed. And may God be greatly glorified and greatly honored today. Father, you can do that. And Father, we just pray again, you will just bless the ministry here in Drumgooland and Kilkinamurry. And that God will be glorified in this area and pour out your love in it, in a way that will bring glory and honour and praise to your great and good and loving name. Amen. We're going to sing again, "Oh for a Closer Walk with God."
Oh,
Let us pray. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen.